All righty. So, how's it looking, man? Cameras are good. This is good. Well, this is good. It's good enough. Good enough. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Melbourne Unreal. I'm Tony Jack the Bear Mance, and we're coming to you from Deluxe Mastering Studios in Melbourne, Australia. We are the world's most livable city, and I'm absolutely rapt to have my good friend and brother, Pete Liner. Pete!
How's it going?
Good, man. How are you?
Good, mate. Good.
Good to have you along. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
So, Pete is a man of many talents. He wears quite a few hats. He runs a thing called DJ Insider. We'll talk a little bit about that. He also has, he's a life coach, and which is at PeteLiner.com.
Yep.
LYNAGH, but we'll put all that up on the screen for you. Stage fright management, which is a new venture, but the one we're going to particularly start with, and the one I'm really into and excited for Peter about, is called Make a Stranger's Day. So anyway, Pete, again, thanks for coming, and so tell us about Make a Stranger's Day, and what is it, and how did it come about for you?
So Make a Stranger's Day is a pay it forward initiative, which involves cafes, coffee, kindness, and connection.
Mm-hmm.
And then with an injection of social media, mm-hmm. primarily Instagram.
Okay.
So how it came about was a funny story. I had a big gym sesh down at St. Kilda Seabass one morning.
Mm-hmm.
Went to a coffee shop afterwards and thought I'd treat myself to a muffin and a coffee, as you do. Straight after training. So,
of course.
I was like, right, cool. Pulled up to the coffee shop, went in, or didn't go in, just to the kiosk outside.
Mm-hmm.
Was looking at the muffins, and they were just straight out of the oven, mm-hmm. steam coming off them. Ordered a coffee, and I was trying to choose which muffin I wanted. And in amongst this, there was this little lady. She must have been about 90 years old. She looked a bit like Yoda. Same height as Yoda.
Yeah.
And she came up, and she just grabbed onto my arm like this, and she was like, oh, they look good, they look good.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, which one would you pick? And she says, oh, it's too early in the morning for me, but I like those look pretty good. And I says, get one, buy yourself one. She says, no, it's too early in the morning for me. So then she says, can I have a coffee, please, to the barista chick? And that was all right. So I ordered and stood back, and she was just standing. She's just a shriveled up old lady, just very cute. And then she said to the barista, she says, I'm going to take my coffee inside. So she was like, yep, that's cool. So the little lady walked in. So I was like, right. Before this, but actually she went to pay for her coffee, and she was going through her purse and there was all shrapnel, and I was sort of in two minds, should I pay for this or will she get offended, or, you know, she was struggling to count out the change for her coffee. So I let it be, and anyway, she said, I'll take the coffee inside. So she went in and sat down, so I was like, right, I'm going to buy her one of these muffins.
Yeah.
So I went up to the barista and I says, just, I'll pay for one of these muffins for him, the one that she picked. So that was cool. I thought I would have been away at this stage. So she got the muffin, went inside, and 2 seconds later, this little Yoda lady came running out and just grabbed me round the neck, just thanking me, and she was welled up, like I welled up, because she says, no one has ever done this or something like this for me.
Mm.
And I wasn't expecting it. It caught me off guard, so I got emotional. Mm. There were 2 gay guys standing here. They were just like, oh, like they got emotional.
Yeah.
The barista chick who seen it all happen, and I can see her getting emotional. So wow. I was just like, and then she says, thank you so much. She says, I'll not eat it all. And I says, don't, just take it home with you or do whatever. So she went back inside. I got my coffee and muffin and just left this scene of kindness that was observed.
Mm.
And it just really got me thinking of how can we do this in such a way that everybody can get involved, or we can do something in this day and age. How can I maximize this or evolve this into some idea? So that was the instigator of Make a Stranger's Day.
Mm.
And like the girl was just, she was like, that was so nice of you, the barista or the cashier. She was just like, that was so nice of you. And I was like, ah, it's just, you know, it's just doing a good thing.
That's just how you roll, Peter.
Yeah,
just how you roll, dude.
So that was the initial day of where it came from.
So from that point, from that point of inspiration, where then did that go? So how did you create this entity that's now up and running.
So I sat down with a few people just bouncing ideas around, because I don't have all the answers. Like, I've got a catalyst of an idea, but and it's up in the clouds usually. I hang around in the clouds most of the time.
Yeah, well, everything's thought,
ideas.
But everything is thought. Everything that we manifest comes originally started as a thought. You know, this desk, even you and I, man, it was a thought in your mum and dad's mind.
Twinkle in my dad's eye.
Exactly. So anyway, you're thinking about all this stuff, and you engage some people to help you with the areas.
It was just to bounce ideas off of how can this be done in the modern day and age. So I know the pay it forward coffee thing, like, it's been around for a long time, and buying homeless a coffee or leaving a coffee, suspended coffees for people.
Mm-hmm.
But I developed this idea of leveraging Instagram and how it could work plugged in, because everyone loves a Instagram picture and everyone loves a selfie.
Yeah.
So how can I leverage off that, and have that injection of kindness and in a non-narcissistic way in behind it. So developed the idea, and it's for about a month or two, and got to the stage that we agreed that we're going to have stickers. Okay, so bear with me. So say we've got I've agreed with the top 20 cafes in Melbourne,
mm-hmm,
to become Mega Stranger Day host.
Mm-hmm.
So this runs for a week. So July 1st to July 7th. So it ties into the end of the financial year and the start of Dry July.
Yeah.
Cool. And I wanted to do it for a week because I feel that these other things that have been happening before, they dissolve over time, they lose momentum. And for me, I just want to do a week, bang, of like a lot of hype around it, and then bang, it happens then.
Yeah.
And then we can tell a story afterwards and then ramp up for next year. So I want to do like an annual thing. So it's like a November time frame style thing.
Okay.
Like November was just 30 guys at the start trying to grow the biggest mustache. There was no money involved. So they had to start somewhere.
Yeah.
So this for me is, I think it's going to be a pretty big thing globally. Fingers crossed. That's the vision I have. So what happens? So a cafe becomes Mega Stranger Day host. Okay. Saying I walk in to a cafe and pay my bill or ordering a takeaway coffee, the cashier says to me, do you want to make a stranger's day? And I go, what's this all about? Tell me more. He says, oh, it's paying it forward. You purchase a coffee, I take your name, write it down in one of these stickers, and someone that comes in after, they don't have to pay, they get the sticker on their coffee cup, and it's from you.
Mm.
So okay, so I'll run you through how it works. So saying I go into this coffee shop, order coffee, or I pay for the coffee, pay it forward, the cashier asks for my name, so it's Pete. So the logos and the stickers are on a clipboard behind where the cashier hangs out.
Mm-hmm.
So pretty cool logos, big happy smiley face.
Okay.
And the cashier writes down Pete inside one of the stickers.
Mm-hmm.
I pay for it, and then they give me a blank sticker, and I just stick it on my phone or stick it on my chest. So I leave with something that's tangible. I've done a good thing.
Yep.
I feel good.
Yep.
I don't know where it's going to go.
Yeah.
So the barista sees a kindness in action, and they feel good because they've witnessed it. So there's a thing called the observer effect in psychology, and it states that anyone that even witnesses
an act of kindness,
they get as much
out of it,
chemical in your body wise than the person that's even doing it.
Right.
Okay. So that's what I suppose.
Well, look what happened in that time at the St Kilda Bars. I mean, your act of kindness affected the two gay guys, it affected the barista, yourself obviously.
Yep.
You know, so there you go. It's just right there, just proof of that.
And that was one of the things that instigated it all. So I learned about that, the observer effects, and that made me think more about this, how to develop this.
Mm-hmm.
So that's okay. So I've left,
mm-hmm,
and they tell me to go to makeastrangersday.com and go follow Instagram to find out what I do next. So it's easy for the cashier. They just go to Make a Stranger Day on Instagram, or go to the website to see what you have to do next. So I'm leaving. I'm on my phone, going on to Instagram straight away with a sticker or whatever. Yeah. What's this all about? So the curiosity, the mystery is there.
Yeah.
And then I go, I go onto the Instagram, follow it, and in the Instagram we've got instructions. We hope your day. Hey stranger, we hope your day has been made. Can you please take a picture of yourself with your new sticker And upload it
to Instagram.
With a couple of sentences off your experience and tag in the venue.
That
the kindness happened.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. And check for your name or whatever down the line. So that's, I'm the giver. That's my job done. Mm-hmm. So now I'm waiting to see what happens next. So I went on and said my little piece. Mm-hmm. Someone else comes in. Say you come in to the cafe and you order a coffee and you go to pay for it. And the cashier goes, no, this has been paid for. So they put the sticker with my name, put it on your coffee cup. He bought this. You grab the coffee and go, what the fuck's this all about?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And they tell you, go to Make a Stranger's Day on Instagram or go to a website to see what happens next. So you're all happy. They've witnessed another good turn.
Yeah.
So the barista is probably the person that gets the most out of all this.
No doubt.
Do you know what I mean?
Because
they see both sides.
Absolutely.
And they get to choose who the person is.
Yeah.
So you leave with your coffee, with a sticker, and the same again. You go on Instagram and you find the instructions. Welcome, stranger. We hope your day has been made. Can you please take a picture of you and your sticker and upload it? A couple of sentences off your experiences. Tag in the venue. And say thank you to the person that bought you the coffee.
Yeah.
Or tag them in.
Mm-hmm.
So it's usually, we'll just leave the name, because if you left your username, your Instagram username, it could breach the privacy sort of stuff. So just your first name.
Yeah.
So as the giver from that like I'm going to be later on that day to see who's going to say thanks, Pete.
Yeah, right.
And then you can start a conversation from there. You don't know, you might end up with a stalker for life, or you might end up marrying your future husband or wife.
Yeah, you don't
know.
Yeah.
Hopefully the latter.
Yeah.
And that's the process. So, like, it's feel good factor 1, 2, 3. And then at the end of the week, the coffee shops are going to, they'll have a transaction. So it's coffee in, coffee out, tick box. They'll have a couple of sheets, say they've transacted 500 coffees that week for this process.
Yeah.
They will then donate a dollar amount per coffee to a charity of their choice.
Got it.
So each cafe owner, or you know, the people that are involved with the cafe, they usually have an affiliation with some sort of charity
that, or that organization.
Yeah. So instead of me coming in with my charity ideas, let them. It keeps it local. It keeps it, you know, their focus.
Yeah.
And it might mean more to them. Mm. So, and they've agreed to do that, which is cool. So there's multiple charities winning off this. But the driver for me to do this is, I'm not too bigly fussed about selfies and coffees and stickers.
Mm.
For me, my driver is, in amongst all those Instagram posts, I'm going to be promoting all the change makers, social enterprises, smaller charities around the world that are doing really good shit.
Right.
And I'm going to promote them. But it's subtle. Okay, so I suppose, and then people are going to look for their selfies, but they're going to come across these other people that are doing really good work. You know, like your Preston Smiles, your BC Cernas, all these guys, and like different social enterprises that are doing really good shit around the world that don't get that much exposure. So I suppose it's leveraging our egoic structure in the sense of selfie, look at me, haha, I done a good thing today.
Yeah.
But in behind it, there's going to be that subconscious promotion of these other really do-gooders.
They're doing good shit that otherwise wouldn't get
the
recognition, because that's the thing, man. It's like so many people doing good work around the world and that we don't know about, even in the internet age. You know, I mean, some people go about it very quietly and they're happy to be working under the radar, and that's great. But what I find is that the money that we raise doing those Jack DeBeer Foundation mastering drives is that it amazes me how virtually every charity that we've been able to, you know, make a donation to, they all just say how they always need more. They need more help. And and some of them are a bit better with marketing themselves. Some are not that great. But I think it's a great initiative, man, to help these guys, again, do something that they probably don't have the resources for.
Yeah.
And like you said, there's a subtlety about it as well. So they probably don't feel like they're being pushed out, or they're commercializing themselves or...
Yeah, it's not like you're just saying sponsor me. Like, it's not saying people, here's a charity, can you sponsor me?
Just give me the money. Yeah,
It's secondary. It's secondary, but leveraging off what people love and the Instagram world and how things are these days and stuff. And it's what was I going to say? It's about just leveraging what is happening at that minute. Yeah. Instagram's a pretty hot thing at the minute. It's like it's probably, you know, after Facebook, you know, the top thing.
Which incidentally they're both owned.
Yeah.
They're both in the same brand, the same company.
Yeah. And I just think it ties in really, really well. So this year, just going to test it in Melbourne with the top 20 cafes. Yeah. I'm looking for a partner, a sponsor for this year, like a 5 grand package. I'm going to, by the time this goes out, I'll have a possible crowdfunding
campaign
just to get the ball rolling, start the website's done. Instagram's being populated at the minute. It's just make a stranger's day. Yeah, so I'll be interested to see how it goes. I've got really good feedback from all the cafe owners.
I was going to ask you,
they love it.
What's the response been? Yeah.
I was in New York last week. I pitched it to the Conscious magazine. They love it. They're going to do a story on it when it's ready. I want to get on the project with this as well. And I want to get broad shape everyone involved.
Yeah.
Because it's just combining. I think the feel good psychological factor is that alone is dying a slow death. People want more than a psychological feel good fact, you know, the factor.
Yeah, yeah.
So if we can use the egoic structure to our advantage, and then off the back of it have the psychological feel good factor, and then in amongst it is connecting them and exposing them to these other charities, it's like a triple whammy.
Yeah.
Rather than just a psychological feel good factor, because I feel that sponsorship, fundraising, just directly, is dying a slow death. People want more, better
value?
Ways.
A value, maybe? Do you think they want value too?
Yeah, I think value and appreciation
is
things that you might not think is important whenever you're giving to charity, but if you can do it, I think it works better.
Mm-hmm.
Because gratitude goes a long way. No matter, do you know what I mean? If you're feeding the homeless or something, and it's just they just take it or something, you know, like there's been instances of different types of I suppose charity work, and feeling the gratitude, there is no gratitude coming back, and it makes you just question why you're doing this, like. And if you get someone that's really grateful, it makes you, you know, it's a transaction. I think it's a transaction of energy,
mm-hmm.
ultimately.
Mm-hmm.
But I think if you can do it, that, you know, there's a thanks involved, and you can, because if you're buying like those suspended coffees, you don't know who's getting the coffee, you don't know where it's going or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But at least that's where you can track and see, and you can either comment or not comment.
Yeah.
It's up to you.
Yeah,
whether
right.
they pick
if you want to interact or not. Yeah,
if
yeah.
you want to, and but at least you see.
Yeah.
And you see someone smiling.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just that. It's just trying to keep that up in a non-narcissistic way. So it's instead of me going, hey, I just bought this guy coffee, chick chick. it's keeping it separate, but then bringing it back together on Instagram. And if you choose, you can comment and get involved in the conversation. Or you can just sit back and go, yeah, I done a good thing.
Absolutely.
So it's just leveraging modern day technology and promoting kindness, connection, and fun. It's just fun.
Mm.
Like, that's another big factor for me. It's just a fun factor.
I've noticed lately, we had a girl called Giddy Love on my older podcast, and you know, she was a girl that went out and was involved with companies and putting together marketing campaigns for people, more conscious driven, so more about, you know, the fair trade and the, you know, the stuff that was, you know, kind to the earth, and ticking all these boxes that were, you know, wasn't just about profitability, but, you know, what were the companies that were caring for people, what were the companies that were contributing towards society, what were the companies that were, you know, doing similar kind of thing to you. And while I hate to call it an industry, I guess it is, but I can see there's more and more of that going on in the world. You know, even like, you know, now there's options where you can go into superannuation funds that strictly deal with, you know, companies that, you know, that are more ethical, you know, and that promote themselves that way and whatnot. I think it's great. I think it's healthy, man.
Yeah, social enterprises are the future. It's like, you know, your Tom's shoes, you buy a pair of shoes from Tom's, they donate a pair to someone that needs them, you know. So it's like, why would I not do that? So you're paying for a service, yes, but you're also getting a psychological feel good factor from that. So it's just combining stuff.
I think that's so important, man, because, you know, a lot of us, when we think about abundance and wealth and stuff like that, or certainly in my recent revelations of it all, is, you know, when we feel gratitude and when we express that, We again, it's what your mind's focused to. If we're thinking about, oh, we don't have enough of this, or we need more for this, or it's a scarcity mindset.
Yeah.
And so once we start thinking more about what we're lacking, that's more about focusing on what we lack. So if we focus on what we lack, it's always going to be about lacking, what we're short on. Whereas when we, you know, they say that wealth is a perception of abundance that is triggered by gratitude. So it all starts there. So, you know, when we not just, you know, it's great to sort of think, yeah, I'm grateful, but feeling it, where heart and mind is connected to it, you're feeling it, and so that's who you're focusing on. And so the more you focus on, the more you attract. And,
yeah,
you know, and I think that makes a lot of sense. And I think your initiative is fucking awesome, man. It's great.
Yeah, I think so. So time will tell. 1st of July, there's going to be the rollout. And hopefully, as I say, if we look for any sponsors that want to partner, they see the value in partnering and the exposure it's going to get. And yeah, I want to get on the project. I think it'd be a really good thing for the project to talk about.
Yeah, they love that kind of shit, man. I mean that I don't really watch a lot of mainstream media, but the odd time I have been on there, I mean, they tend to promote that kind of stuff. It's not, I mean, it's all the doom and gloom and shit and bombs and war and terrorism and all that kind of stuff, but they still do take the time out to do a more lighthearted story and something that's a bit more cheerful and a bit more uplifting. So yeah. You know.
Yeah, so that's...
I don't see that. You shouldn't have too much problem with that. I mean, especially now that you're starting to get some traction behind it and people coming on board, so there's something there.
Yeah, and I have the relationship being on the project before with the no sex thing as well.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, Pete, so... that was Pete's chastity for charity.
Yeah. So, yeah, well, that's a bit of background that'll help me promote this as well.
Yeah,
the
yeah.
Contacts in the media and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's beautiful. Yeah. How do you see the world?
How do I see the world?
How do you see the world these today?
I see the world, it's a very, very balanced place. I just think because of mainstream media, we see a lot more of the bad than the good. But I think it's completely balanced. I think, yeah, exactly. It's just, we only get to see the bad through all the media channels.
Yeah. Well, that's all very deliberate.
It's all deliberate. Yeah, it's to keep us dumb and it's all
and in
shit.
Fear. And in fear. Yeah. I mean, I read a report a little while ago that said that if you took the average newspaper, radio news broadcast, TV news broadcast, it ended up being about 19-1 was the ratio between the bad stories and the good stories. And I mean, at the end of the day, the media's role is simply to do one thing, and that's get your attention.
Mm.
And people, and the best way to connect people's hearts and minds is through fear.
Mm-hmm.
That's where you get them in. And people, you know, we're a species that just, for some reason, we just have this insatiable appetite for certainty. We need to fucking know what is going on. And so it's like what people like soap operas. So the news is there, it grabs us. So we're, oh, what's going to happen next? What's going to happen next? They get the numbers up, and then that's what justifies their advertising fees to the sponsors. You know, I mean, they're just drip feeding the amygdala, a part of your brain that mm-hmm. is there to recognize right fear first.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's just done by stealth, and it's done in a very insidious way. And so I think the way I see the world right now is I think the world is, I'm feeling some kind of fucking shift, man. This is not me being a fucking amby-pamby hippie who's just come off kumbaya.com. But I feel it, man. The more and more people I see and talk to, I think more people starting to awaken to a fact that, you know, things could be better. Mm-hmm. And that the system, it's not perfect, but it could be better. And I think more people starting to become, we're seeing more kindness in the world. We're seeing, you know, again, through the internet, these random acts of kindness, more people doing good things to the world, and more exposure, that sort of thing. And I think as that energy lifts and lifts and lifts and people start, you know, especially getting off mainstream media, man.
Yeah.
That's a fucking big... That in itself, that'll help you more than anything. Even exactly. If you don't care about all the other stuff, just so that you can function more. You know, like when people say, well, fuck, how are you going to know what's going on? Are you fucking serious, man? If something's big enough, you'll hear about it.
Exactly.
You'll fucking hear about it, man. So, yeah. You know,
question everything. That's my advice.
And follow the money. Follow the fucking money. Yeah. That's fucking great, man. Well, I hope it fucking goes off for you.
Yeah, I hope so. Because the more exposure these change makers get around the world that are doing awesome work.
Oh, totally, man. It just picks up, and it's an energetic thing, you know. And people are, we are creatures of conformity. So the more of that shit that gets out there and people hook into, then I just kind of roll with it, and that's how you build your momentum.
Yeah, and with this, like, this consciousness waking up.
Yeah,
like, it's, and that's what people are going to buy into more and more over the years to come.
Yeah,
it's you're still going to have your negative egoic structure.
That's just something that'll be there for, I don't know about forever and a day, but certainly you can count on it to always play a role.
You know?
So the other thing you do, you're a life coach.
Yep.
How long you been doing that for?
Probably 9 years. 9 years.
And what got you into that?
7 years.
What got you into that?
Just personal development. Just having a bit of a rough upbringing, as everyone does, and then getting to the stage that, what am I fucking doing with my life? Do I want to be an electrician for the rest of my life?
Because that's your original that's why trade?
I got kicked out of school, and my next door neighbour was my cousin. He was an electrician, so I thought, I'll be an electrician too.
Mm-hmm.
That's just the way it was. Simple. Get a trade behind you.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the
Is in Dublin?
This is in Northern Ireland.
Yeah,
so that was a pretty much of a cultural, I don't know if it's was that what it was like here, but everyone said, get a trade behind you, and then work out what you want to do. But then you get a fucking trade behind you, and you get stuck being a tradesman for the rest of your life.
Mm-hmm.
So I was a tradesman 12 years, electrician 12 years, came to Australia in 2007, was still an electrician. Great industry, paid well, like nothing wrong with electricians. That's fuck up, you know, I can't say a bad word.
Mm.
But for me, I just thought there's more to life. So I started seeing a counsellor before I came to Australia. And she gave me a book called Feel the Fear and Do It Anyway by Susan Jeffers.
Mm.
And I'd never read a book in my life up until then. The most I would have read was probably FHM magazine or something.
Yeah, right.
So this book for me was a total eye opener. I don't know if you read it.
No, I don't read books. I'm not a great reader. The only books I've ever read, to be honest, I reckon I maybe read 10, and two books in particular I read because they were given to me by my friends, and I just, you know, I read them out of obligation, you know, because I didn't want to be caught out. And I'm being very honest here. I just didn't want to be caught out next time I see them, and they may have thrown some kind of question. I wanted to be able to answer it so they knew I read it. So, and it was painful, man. I don't know. Reading, right. For some people, reading is joy. It opens up the imagination. I just get stuck, man. I'm trying to work on it, but, you know, blogs, short articles, I'll watch a video.
Yeah.
But now I'm just honest with my friends. I had got Kim Lajoie from Obsessive Music. We run these workshops here every month or so with musicians, and he's written a book, and it's a very thin book. But I just thought, you know, I'm just gonna be honest with the cunt. So listen, man, I love you, but I'm just not gonna read it. I just don't read. I just don't read. So anyway, go on.
So it was a sensational book. So it's just personal development, and it really opened my eyes up to why I was doing what I was doing and why I wasn't doing the stuff I thought I could do. And that was it. I was a sponge. So I just ate book after book. And it was just educational for me. So it's just, like, I started my learning basically when I was 27. I started my real education when I was 27. And it was just seminar after seminar, audio book after audio book. So I was walking around the building site with headphones in, and listening.
Some people are fucking junkies on that, aren't they? I mean,
I was a junkie.
There's nothing wrong with it, but you know what? I think the self-help industry, while I think it's great and it's certainly done a lot of good for people, I think, as my mentor Peter Sage would say, you know, self-help is now becoming more and more shelf-help.
Yeah.
So a lot of people reading the stuff, they do it, but how many people actually apply, you know? And that's the thing, man, like, so many of us, we have this intellectual level of understanding of about a lot of things, whether it's how to, you know, run a business, losing weight, but yet, you know, we know what to do, but then people don't do what they know.
Yeah.
And as the saying goes, you know, knowing and not doing is the same as not knowing.
Yeah, knowledge is power, but it's only potential power.
Yeah, and not until that information, you know, it becomes wisdom, you know, and you start practicing.
Yeah, and experience that. It.
Exactly, you know.
That's the hard part, it's going through that, and it's usually a shitstorm.
Most definitely, especially when it's something new.
And that's why people, no, I can't handle this, I'll just go back to read my book.
Yeah.
It tells me what I should do.
Yeah,
and I feel good reading this book.
Yeah.
But I was trapped in that zone for a long, long time before I And I had so much knowledge, so much knowledge. I can tell you anything about the Law of Attraction. I can tell you anything about anything of those books. I read thousands of books.
Yeah.
But I was too scared to push through what I had to push through and face up to the shit that was stopping me. Yeah. That's the scariest part.
I think that's what happens to a lot of people. When, you know, both of us have had our own respective journeys of going through, and I still am, you know, going through my own transformative process. But you're right. There is a point where you have to face up to some fear. You have to get over some blockages. And there are times when you can probably feel lonely. You can feel not worthy. You can feel like, oh, I'm not cut out for this. Absolutely. You know, because it is hard. There's no doubt about it. You know, people can sit there and whether you're a life coach or self-help guy and say, oh, you can do it. You can do it. And you must do it. And it's all well intended, but it's... And they make it sound simple, even though they have had their own journey and have demonstrated it. But, you know, they don't need to scare people off. But I think sometimes there is that lack of sensitivity in helping people understand and explain, you know, hey, you know what? This is not going to be easy, but it's going to be worth it. You will experience this, and you will experience that. And we can try and support you through that. And that's where people give up too quickly, man.
And it's all in your own time, too.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
'Cause everyone's journey is different.
For sure.
And it's just, and that time will happen when it's supposed to happen. So you can have a coach and he can just push you and push you and push you and nothing's happening. Mm-hmm. And you wonder if this guy, but at the end of the day, no one can, I can't help anyone. You have to help yourself.
Oh, definitely. I think that's the biggest thing I learned.
Mm. Like, I was trying to help everyone. I was reading these books and I was like, oh, you need to read this, you need to do this. I've done this, and I'm feeling great. But ultimately I call that the spiritual ego trap.
Yeah.
That's what that place is.
Yeah.
It's like knowing all this stuff but not applying it or doing anything about
it. Yeah. And like I said, you can't help those who want to help themselves. And I went through a similar where it really hit me, that concept, and where, again, I knew it intellectually, but once I experienced it, when I started out my inspirational speaking and mentoring, when I officially launched it, I was really interested in two streams. One was young kids and the artistic creative kids, particularly because that's my world and that's been my journey. But I also thought, you know what, I've been through my own shit as a middle-aged man, the midlife crisis, being overweight, you know, doing way too many drugs, unhappy marriage, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Gone through that, was able to document my journey. I thought, okay, well, this is good. You know, there's probably a lot of middle-aged men who need help and who are looking for help. You can present yourself as someone who's got a track record in at least going through a process that you can feel empathy for them and show. But here's what I found. When I attempted to do these kind of things or events there was just too many fucking jaded guys. Guys were there, for example, because the magistrate court said, well, if I don't go to this course and do this anger management, I'm going to go to jail, or I'm going to have to pay a fine, or the missus made me go, or I kind of want to do it, but again, they're shooting themselves in the foot before they start. And it's very difficult to drag people out, as you know.
It doesn't work.
Kids, on the other hand, are different because they still, I mean, while some kids have grown up and they've had shit upbringing and whatnot, but they're not as jaded. And for many of them, they want to learn. They're interested. And those kids, you can help, you know.
Oh, yeah.
You can do, well, you can't, well, as our friend Jordan says, you can't help anyone. You can only serve them.
Yeah.
But at least they're open to it.
Yeah, what the big thing about kids is they don't have to change their minds. They just have to make up their minds.
Yeah.
And that's the difference between kids and adults.
Yeah. Yeah.
Massive difference.
Yeah. I agree. What are the kind of people that you, in your coaching, what kind of people in the industries would you attract? Or
usually the people that I attract is people very similar to myself, because that's just the law of attraction, that you haven't actually got a say in that matter. So I'll attract people who have either are going through the same shit or have been through the same shit as I have. Mm-hmm. And that's just the way the world works. Mm-hmm. You know, that's just how it works.
Yeah.
So it can vary from high-end businessman, it can vary to younger adolescent kids who are just lost their way.
Mm-hmm.
And it can be women in bad relationships. It can be anything. So it's just, it varies. But at the end of the day, the fundamentals are the same and they have to go through it. That's it.
Do you find there's any particular things that keep coming up in terms of just broad issues with your clients?
Probably relationships and finances, because that was my two biggest things.
Yeah.
So, and they're both the same, ultimately.
Yeah.
It's the same energy.
Yeah. I recently, again, my learnings, I came across this guy called Dan Pena, who's a crazy motherfucker. He's 70-year-old. He's known as a $50 billion man. I saw him on London Real. He's quite a character. But he talked about the concept of that we have two bank accounts, and Peter talks about this too in his teachings, but two bank accounts. we have a financial bank account, but we have an emotional bank account. But for people to have their emotional bank account up, they need to feel that they have the financial bank account needs to be up first. And it's just this treadmill that never works. Whereas what the thinking is, if you focus on your emotional bank account, get yourself feeling good, get yourself healthy, get yourself right, then you'll attract the other stuff, and then that will have more of a correlation depending on there. So focusing on that rather than the other way around. So the thing is, you don't become wealthy by having money in the bank. You get money in the bank when you become wealthy.
Yeah.
So it's that whole idea and living it, and not in a fake it till you make it, because that's all head. That's not a congruent thing where you feel it. Exactly.
And that's what Warren Buffett says, until you can control your emotions, you'll never control money.
Yeah. You know, and that's absolutely right. So how long have you been doing so you said you're about 9 you've been coaching for, and you got a website, we'll put it up mm-hmm. there for people to have a look at.
Cool.
Tell us about DJ Insider, because, you know, we're mastering music and mastering life, so we might as well do some...
DJ Insider was a bit of a dream for me come true. So actually, I did dream it. It was I used to DJ growing up since I was 14. I had a set of decks, used to run like different nights back home in Ireland, inviting DJs, and loved the scene, loved it. Like, was party boy hard whenever I was growing up, like the drug scene, whatever, and used to club all around the world.
Yeah,
loved it. And then, probably about 4 years ago, had a dream about setting up a company that records DJs up close and personal, because I felt there was a bit of a gap in the market. There's no one that gets up and gets a bit of a story, like personal, inspiration and stuff that, where it was just nightclubs and videos and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So set up DJinsider.tv, and have been plugging away at that, creating really good content, like flying around the world, Ibiza, Europe and stuff, and LA, and recording DJs that inspire me. And it's been a really interesting process of learning business and learning video production and learning social media. So it's everything happens for a reason, as you know, and now it's still running in the background. We're doing Skype recording interviews, sessions.
I really like that one you do with Mike Callender, man. I'm going to get Mike on the show. He's an absolute gent.
So we're actually doing some partnership with School of Synthesis.
Yeah, awesome.
So we're going to be doing a little short video music production hacks, like 30-second hacks.
Nice.
With Mike, because he, I haven't met a more fucking nice bloke. It's just a legend of a guy.
He's the tits. I remember I met Mike years ago when he was working at a Stomp, the distribution company, and you know, he was working sales and boxing records and stuff, and this fresh-faced kid. And I like him in the start, man, and you know, he's just the classic great story of a self-starter, a guy who's passionate, but he's just a fucking sweetheart too. And as he has been climbing the ranks and getting more profile and better gigs, you know what? He's still the same bloke.
Yeah.
He's still a fucking sweetheart.
Got his roots.
No fucking tickets on him whatsoever, you know, and understands that great important thing of, it's nice to be important, but it's more important to be nice.
Yeah.
And he fucking breathes that shit, man.
Because you put me on to him. It was you that said, oh, this guy wants to know more about transcendental meditation.
Yep.
I started transcendental meditation. I messaged them, and we didn't catch up. And then I was in Revolver about maybe 3 months ago, and I was in the main room, and I heard these wicked beats. And I was like, who the fuck is that? He's in the cage.
Yeah.
And my mate Ollie says, oh, it's Mike Callender. And I say, that's Mike Callender? Fuck. It was blinding.
Yeah.
And then we met after that, and I was like, let's get you on for an interview, because that was tremendous.
Yeah, no, it was good fun.
But yeah, he's really good contact, and the stories that he had on the interview was Very
funny. It was funny. It was funny. It was definitely funny. I'm looking forward to getting him on. I will get him on eventually. Hopefully sooner or later, because Mike's a great story. And I think for young kids who are into it, just to listen to him and his journey and what he's done, I think they'll get a fuckload out of it. All right, my friend. It's been an absolute pleasure to have you here. Thanks for coming down.
Cool, man. Thanks for having me.
Good luck with your ventures. If I'm knowing you the way I do and how driven you are, and the one thing I really like about you, man, there's a lot of things I like about you, but the one thing I really like about you is the self-belief you have in yourself, and how even when you and I have discussions, and sometimes you'll call me out on my bullshit, and you'll question me on things, it's a self-doubt or self-belief thing, and I really admire that in people that will step up, and I've often said you're good mates. Your real friends will say good things behind your back and shit things to your grill.
Yeah.
And I think that's true. And so that's one of the things I really appreciate about you. But I guess your self-belief and your humor like anyone else, but I do admire the fact that, when you come and you sat me down first time and explained it, you spoke about it as if you fucking knew, man, that this was predestined in a way. And I think that's important. I think that's a healthy ego. Yeah, but like I said, but it's not just your mind. It's when your heart, when you're coming from that place of authenticity, when that intention is right, and so
it's congruent.
Yeah. So when you spoke about it, I really had no doubt that it was not going to work in some way, shape, or form. This was going to be something, and I sincerely fucking hope so, man. I'd be very surprised. Put it this way, it won't be through lack of effort on your behalf. That's for sure.
Yeah, it's funny, I went to St. Ali in South Melbourne.
Yep.
And spoke to Salvatore Malatesta, he's one of my mentors, he probably doesn't know that, but really successful businessman, opening cafes, Jakarta, all over the world.
Mm.
And I had the two-pager brief, and he started reading it, and I started telling him about it, and he just put it down, he says, let's do it. He says, I love your energy, I love where your heart is, you can have all my coffees, let's do it. And I was like, do you not want to read? He says, I trust you, and that, for me, I just got goosebumps. I was like, fuck, that's really humbling for me to hear that from this guy. And it just from my energy.
Yeah.
And like, I know about energy and stuff, but that was someone confirming that for me. That made me feel really, really good.
It's the positive reinforcement of what you're doing. And as I say, you can't bullshit a bullshitter.
No. So my advice is to, for anyone to just get on and do something, but see it as done. See it as you want it. See the end result. And then reverse engineer it from there.
Definitely. Beautiful.
Anything can be done in this world.
Peter, let me give you a hug, man. I love the fuck out of you, man. You're fucking awesome. You're great. Thank you so much, my friend.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming down. Keep us posted as to how things are going for you. And
if there's any sponsors that want to get involved, any partners, just email me at pete@makeastrangersday.com. I'd be more than happy to speak to anyone.
Beautiful. All right. Thanks very much for watching, guys. I love you fuckers. Please remember, be nice to each other, but more importantly, be nice to yourselves. Okay, catch you later, guys. Bye.